Yes alumni yang di sini siap untuk berbagi cerita nih. Jadi kalau misalnya kalian ada pertanyaan, kalian penasaran, Kak, Amerika tuh gimana sih? Itu please silahkan itu ditanyakan nanti ya. Nanti ada para alumni-nya, ada para Yes Abroad student-nya langsung. Dan kalau misalnya kayak kalian ragu nih kayak, aduh Kak, tapi aku takut nih bahasa Inggris aku nggak sebagus itu. It's okay. We got you here. Pokoknya kalau misalnya kalian ragu itu, kalian teks aja di chat box itu, kalian tulis aja bahasa Indonesia. Nanti kita bantu untuk nge-translatein ke para teman-teman Yes Abroad. Jadi mungkin kita sebelum mulai langsung, buat teman-teman yang tidak bisa bergabung, jangan lupa kita juga live streaming di YouTube. Jadi bisa bergabung via YouTube, di YouTube-nya Binantar Budaya. Dan kalau misalnya pun belum ngecek yang sesi pertama nih, Kak, aku nggak tahu ternyata 27 Maret ada sesi ini. Nggak apa-apa, karena live-nya itu ada di YouTube kita. Jadi nanti jangan lupa habis itu langsung di-check out aja. Okay, without further ado, mungkin kita langsung aja ke perkenalan para speakers dan juga moderator kita. Perkenalkan dulu kita para Yes Abroad students ini. Silakan, let's introduce yourself dari Michael. Michael.
Hello, namaste, Michael, Santi Garzi, Alabama.
Okay, hello, Michael. Atau panggilnya Connor ya, or we call you Connor. Okay, and then after knowing a little bit about Connor, we're gonna go to Jesus. Jesus.
Hello, selamat pagi di Indonesia. Nama saya Jesus. Saya tinggal di Georgia.
Halo, selamat malam Jesus. Okay, after that we're gonna go to Addison. Addison.
Halo, selamat pagi. Nama saya Addison. Saya tinggal di Utah.
Okay, halo, selamat malam Addison. And then after Addison, we're gonna go to Megan.
Hai, selamat pagi. Nama saya Megan. Dan saya tinggal di Pennsylvania. Di Amerika Serikat.
Oke, halo Megan. Tadi kita udah kenalan sedikit nih sama para Yes Abroad students kita. Sekarang kita akan proceed kenalan lebih lanjut kepada para Yes alumni-nya. Silakan Kak Zikra.
Halo semuanya. Aku Zikra Handika, aku alumni dari tahun 15-16. Dulu aku di host di Illinois, near Chicago. Thank you.
Oke, selamat pagi Kak Zikra. Terus sekarang kita akan proceed ke Kak Bianca. Silakan Kak Bianca.
Halo, perkenalkan nama aku Bianca. Aku alumni Yes angkatan 17-18 dan dulu di hosting di Iowa. Thank you.
Oke, thank you Kak Bianca. Selamat pagi dan aku mau perkenalkan diri sendiri juga. Perkenalkan semuanya, nama aku Anya, Anya Ranta. Dulu aku program Yes 2016-2017 di hostnya di Louisiana, jadi di bagian selatan gitu. Salam kenal semuanya dan selamat pagi. Sekarang aku akan mengenalkan nih moderator kita hari ini, yaitu Kak Elsa. Silakan Kak Elsa untuk proceed.
Okay, thank you so much Kak Anya for picking me up. Halo semuanya, teman-teman sekalian. Nama saya Elsa. Elsa ini Yes alumni 2016-2017, was hosted in San Antonio, Texas, USA. Now, karena kita udah kenalan ya, Pak ya, jadi kita bisa langsung aja nih ke apa sih yang kita mau obrolin hari ini. Nah, before that, hari ini kita akan membahas tentang something that we can't live without. Ayo, kira-kira teman-teman udah pada sarapan belum nih pagi ini? Nah, kalau pada belum, kita bakal traktir teman-teman sekalian bahas makanan-makanan yang ada di USA. Gitu. Okay, so the American cuisine will be delivered by Addison, Jesus, Kak Anya, and Kak Bianca. So for you guys, time is yours.
Thank you. Okay, so I'll start off reading. So the American food culture dates back to the 16th century when Indians were the main inhabitants of the United States. At this stage, they laid the foundation for the American staple food, which is corn. In the era of food and clothing, the United States did not form a complete diet system and food system. In the 16th century, the Spanish and Mexico came to the United States. The corn was too single and the tacos were born, which is taco. The influx of European immigrants into the United States in the 17th and 18th centuries led to British cuisine laying the foundations of traditional American cuisine later. African immigrants brought novel food ingredients and spices to the American tables. In the second half of the 19th century, the United States welcomed Chinese and Italian immigrants, and a variety of new American Chinese food emerged. Although Americans eat Chinese food, they don't cook it at home. Americanized Italian food is a staple of American restaurant culture and is popular. After the 20th century, immigrants from all over the world brought in their own national cuisine, and that also reflects the inclusiveness of American food culture.
Okay, next up ada regional cuisines. Kayaknya emang di US tuh ada banyak region ya, dan masing-masing region tuh punya makanannya sendiri.
Wah, iya nih Kak Bianca. Kak Bianca dulu di hostnya di mana nih, Kak?
Aku di Iowa, kalau di map ini yang ada milkshake itu loh, yang kayak agak di tengah-tengah itu. Aku tuh Midwestern daerahnya namanya. Kalau Kaknya?
Kalau aku di bawah, Kak, di sebelah Texas. Kelihatan itu nggak kelihatan sih itu gambar apa, tapi yang di bawah burger itu Kak, dan iya sih aku pernah ke tengah-tengah gitu kan Kak, dan makanannya cukup beda ya ternyata Kak ya.
Emang beda-beda banget. Addison and Jesus, so what state are you from and like what's the food that's like very indicative of your state?
Since I'm unmuted, I can go first. I'm from Georgia, and our state fruit is a peach. It's on driver's license, it's on license plates. It's like Georgia peaches, and that's actually what's on this map. So yeah, that's kind of our thing.
I'm from Utah, and so we actually eat a bunch of different stuff. I can't tell what's on my state, but the thing that my friends and family eat the most is definitely gluten. So like rolls or bread or pies or anything that has gluten in it. And so, yeah, we eat a lot of bread.
Okay, so that's really cool. Jadi tadi di Jesus ada di Georgia, dan yang khas dari daerahnya dia peach, like peach the fruit, or what was it?
Yeah.
Like, oh, okay, buah peach. Yeah. Dan kalau untuk Addison tadi katanya sering banget makan roti, gluten-gluten gitu. Okay, I guess we can move on to the next slide, Kak. Addison, Jesus, you can take turns on this and the next slide.
Okay, so I will do this one. New England region. New England cuisine is an American cuisine which originated in the New England region of the United States and traces its roots to English cuisine. It is characterized by extensive use of seafood and dairy products resulting from its historical reliance on seaports and the fishing industry. Two prominent characteristics of food native to New England are maple syrup and cranberries. And then Addison, you can read the Mid-Atlantic one.
Thank you. The Mid-Atlantic states comprise the states of New York, New Jersey, Delaware, Pennsylvania, and Northern Maryland. The influences on cuisine in this region are extremely eclectic, owing to the fact that it has been and continues to be a gateway for international culture as well as a gateway for new immigrants.
Okay, kalau di state-nya Kak Anya itu yang kayak khasnya tuh makanan apa ya, Kak? Atau kecenderungannya tuh makanannya gimana gitu?
Jadi kalau di Louisiana, karena dia di bawah dan dia dekat dengan air ya, dan banyak sungai, jadi kita tuh ini banyak seafood-nya, jadi kita makannya banyak makan ikan, kita juga bumbunya tuh yang namanya tuh, I don't know if people know, tapi namanya Creola, segala macam. Pokoknya macam-macam dan sangat-sangat berbumbu gitu. Jadi dan Southern itu mereka pride-nya adalah mereka juga suka yang pedes-pedes nih Kak. Jadi kan kalau misalnya kita kadang mikirnya, oh bule-bule nggak bisa pedes-pedes. Nah, kalau misalnya ke Saturn tuh, bule-bulenya pada demen nih yang pedes-pedes. Kalau misalnya Kak Bianca gimana nih Kak, pas di state dulu?
Kalau aku tuh ini, jadi sebenarnya state aku kan Iowa. Nah, Iowa itu sebenarnya produsen pork, produsen daging babi terbesar. Jadi kayak ada macam-macam banget. Kayak ada keripik kulitnya, kayak gitu-gitu. Aku nggak makan, obviously, tapi kayak maksudnya sering lihat gitu. Dan juga Iowa tuh terkenal dengan jagungnya. Nah, ini pas banget Iowa tuh di Midwest atau Midwestern. So, Jesus and Addison, you can continue.
I'm going to read Addison's region, and she's going to read mine. The Midwest, sometimes called the breadbasket of America, the Midwest serves as a center for grain production, particularly wheat, corn, and soybeans. These are ingredients that are commonly used in Midwestern states, and they include beef, pork, potatoes, and corn.
All right, and then Southern. Regional and cultural backgrounds shape Southern cuisine, such as Tidewater, Appalachian, Cajun, Creole, Lowcountry, and Floribian, being different types of Southern cuisine. In recent history, elements of Southern cuisine have spread around the United States, having an effect on the development of other types of American cuisines.
Okay. Wah, ini jadi ngiler nggak sih, Kak?
Ngelihat ini ya, ayam goreng tadi tuh. Apa gitu?
Iya. Oh iya, fun fact banget. Jadi kalau misalnya pas aku di state dulu, kan kita kalau misalnya di Indonesia makan ayam goreng sama nasi ya. Pakai nasi, pakai sambal, atau pakai kecap gitu. Tapi kalau di Amerika tuh mereka ini makannya tuh pakai Hawaiian roll. Hawaiian roll tuh dia kayak roti. Roti apa ya? Roti apa sih namanya? Roti yang kayak six pack orang gitu.
Roti bantal.
Oh iya, roti bantal, that's the word.
Roti bantal kali ya, Kak.
Iya, roti manis gitu. Jadi dan awalnya aku ngerasa kayak kok ayam goreng makannya pakai roti manis gitu. Tapi ternyata it works well gitu together. Gitu sih, Kak.
Oh, ini nih Kak Zika nih, Chicago style deep dish. Okay, you guys can continue.
Okay, so then we have the Southwest and Southern California, the states of the Four Corners, Arizona, New Mexico, Colorado, and Utah. Also, Nevada and Southern California and West Texas make up a large chunk of the United States. The cuisine of the Southwestern United States is food styled after the rustic cooking Southwestern United States. It comprises of fusion recipes for things that might have been eaten by Spanish colonial settlers, cowboys, and Native Americans and Mexicans throughout the post-Columbian era. Southwestern cuisine is similar to Mexican cuisine, but often involves larger cuts of meat, namely pork and beef, and less use of tripe, brain, and other parts not considered desirable.
Pacific Northwest cuisine is a North American cuisine of the states of Oregon, Washington, and Alaska, as well as British Columbia and the Southern Yukon, reflecting the ethnic makeup of the region, which noticeable influence from Asian and Native American traditions. With significant migration from other regions of the U.S., influences from Southern cuisine brought by African Americans, as well as Mexican American cuisine as Latinos migrate north from California, can be seen as well.
Okay, nah next up kita masuk ke eating habits. Jadi ada beberapa eating habits yang beda nih antara orang Indonesia sama orang US. Addison, would you like to go first? Like, what's the typical meal times and, you know, like your eating habits in the family?
I would love to. So my family is kind of not normal. So we actually eat very differently than most of America. I would consider us to eat at times that would be considered normal for Europeans. And so my family, we eat breakfast when we wake up, or we don't eat breakfast depending on how busy we are. Lunch is usually around 12 or 1, and then dinner we eat at 8 to 10, so very late. Our daily meals, honestly, we don't really plan meals. We kind of just go and look in the pantry or the fridge and just pick out something for ourselves. But we eat a variety of different things because of the different kinds of food culture that we have here. I end up eating like Chinese food one night, Mexican food the next night, then Greek food, then Italian food. So it really varies depending on like what we're feeling like eating, but we have the whole variety. And then eating with family, most of the time we'll eat separately just on our own time whenever we feel like we're hungry. But every once in a while, like every 2 weeks or so, we have a family dinner where we sit down together and we actually like have a conversation while we eat our food. But yeah, we're not the typical American family, but we definitely have a great time.
Jesus, what about you? Like, how is it in your family?
Pretty different from Addison. Well, usually my family, we don't eat breakfast because in the morning my mom goes to work, I go to school, and my dad goes and works out. So we don't really have time to eat breakfast. So we don't really do it. And then lunchtime is just any random time during the middle of the day when you get hungry. And then my mom comes home from work and cooks around like 4, and we eat about 6 in the afternoon, like 6 or 7. Daily meals, most of the time we don't eat out, like we don't eat a lot of takeout food. We cook at home majority of the time. Every other meal we eat has rice in it, so that's something that I know probably sounds familiar. Every other meal has rice, so that's something that we do a lot of. But most of the time we eat lunch and things alone, and we eat dinner as a family. That's usually how it works in my house.
Ya, jadi Jesus sama kayak kita ya. Jadi di rumahnya juga lumayan sering makan nasi. What about you, Megan? How is it in your family, like your eating habits?
So my family makes it a priority that we eat dinner together almost every night. And usually my mom will cook dinner for breakfast. When I go to school, I usually just grab something like fruit or a bagel, and then I actually eat lunch at my school most days. And then on the weekends, like, I'll just cook for myself.
Sounds nice. Do you get school lunches, or do you bring food from home for lunch?
My school provides lunches. So we usually have like a salad option, and then there's like a hot food, which is like either a hamburger or like some sort of cooked meat. And like there are vegetarian options as well. So, or I could like get a sandwich. So I don't know. There's lots of options for me at school.
Yes. What about you, Michael? Is there like a dish that's like staple, or like that's like what that you always eat?
Well, for me, it's like, my family is very Southern because my mom has like pretty much lived in like the South, like her whole life. So we eat like, we eat a lot of seafood because we're kind of like right next to like Louisiana. So we eat like a lot of crawfish and a lot of shrimp and a lot of fish with like rice and stuff like that. But then we also eat like a lot of barbecue and like a lot of like Southern food, like fried chicken and cornbread and rice and stuff like that. So that's usually what like I eat. And like pretty much like our like daily meals, like both my parents have to go to work like early. So like, I don't really eat breakfast because I have to go to school early also. So we just don't really eat breakfast. And I mean, like I have lunch about like 12, and I like bring my own lunch from because I make it at my house. And I get dinner. Sometimes I eat my family, sometimes I don't. But like my parents get home kind of late, so like I'll usually make dinner for myself, and sometimes they'll make dinner like for all of us.
Nice, lots of seafood. Yeah, jadi karena wilayahnya ya, jadi sering makan seafood.
Kalau Kak Bianca gimana, Kak? Biasanya rutinitas makannya pas di state?
Kalau di US, sebenarnya aku tinggal sama semamku. Semamku single mother ya, jadi emang berdua doang. Maka bener-bener ini banget sih, santai banget. Jadi biasanya paling kayak jam 1, jam 2 makan siang, terus malamnya jam 6, jam 7-an. Terus kayak kayaknya ngebedain gak sih antara supper sama dinner? Karena aku selalu kayak supper. Aku gak merasa pernah ngomong dinner gitu.
Ngebedain sih Kak, soalnya kalau kita, jadi my family itu mereka suka banget dinner, karena dinner tuh adalah kayak kesempatan buat get together-nya gitu. Jadi kita biasanya kalau breakfast sama lunch itu kita bikin masing-masing. Jadi kita mau breakfast, mau enggak, itu terserah sendiri, kita yang usaha sendiri. Kalau enggak mau silahkan, enggak apa-apa, tapi kalau mau, ayo bikin sendiri gitu. Jadi di sana orang tuanya enggak yang ngebikinin gitu. Kan kalau di Indonesia, di sini aku, ibu aku ya, yang kayak pagi itu pasti ngebikinin sarapan segala macam. Paling kalau misalnya lagi kayak waktunya mepet itu, kita ini sangu buah aja gitu buat ke sekolah segala macam. Dan sekolah juga ini apa nyediain makanan. Terus kayak pas malam itu biasanya the mother will cook the dinner. Terus kayak aku sama hostess aku bakal kayak bantu-bantu gitu. And yes, agree. Tadi ini sih, karena baru aja ngechat kalau misalnya sweetie is a huge thing in South. Iya, benar banget. Jadi sweetie itu, jadi kita ada sweetie, ada unsweetened tea. Jadi kita tuh suka banget teh, bahkan kayak di apa fast food gitu. Itu tuh kita ada optionnya gitu. Kan kalau misalnya di Indonesia kayaknya agak jarang ya Kak ya, ada fast food yang menyediakan sweetie gitu. Teh es. Agak jarang.
Teh manis gitu Kak.
Iya, teh manis. Kan kita kalau teh manis kayak di warteg gitu ya. Kalau misalnya di sana tuh malah di fast foodnya. Jadi kayak di KFC, di McD gitu-gitu. Mereka ada ini, ada sweet tea pilihannya. Dan juga ada unsweetened tea. Jadi dia teh lepas gitu. Nggak ada manis-manis. Kali cuma teh aja gitu.
Teh lepas ya, iya.
Bener-bener. Iya gitu.
Iya, kadang tuh sweet tea tuh agak terlalu manis menurut aku. Don't come at me, but... Okay, now we can move on to the next part. So everyone who puts their pictures in here, you can go and explain. We can start from number one, maybe. Go ahead. Ini fotonya siapa? Who has this picture?
Okay, that's mine, and so is the second one, so I'll just stay unmuted. But the first and second picture are from the same restaurant, and Georgia is like technically it's a coastal state, but it's really big, so sometimes a lot of people forget. So me and my family visit the beach a lot, and so we get a lot of really good seafood there. So the first one is a dessert. It's creme brulee, which is French, ta-da, but it's popular in America, so it's just a creme brulee, and it's like a sweet dish with like fruits on it. And then the second one is grilled fish with french fries and corn, and that restaurant is fantastic, and we go there every time we go to the beach. It's wonderful. I want some now.
Okay, is it a big brand, like a chain restaurant, or is it just like a local restaurant?
It's a locally owned restaurant. We vacationed there 1 year, and my dad met the owner at a gas station, and she was like, you should come to my restaurant. And so we went, and it was awesome.
Nice. Enak ya kalau tinggal dekat pantai, jadi sering bisa sering makan ikan gitu ya. Okay, who has number three? You guys can.
That's mine, actually. So number three and number four is mine. I actually want to put like a picture of nacho and enchiladas and rice, but I couldn't find it because that's a really typical Southern food. I was placed in Texas, but number three is like itu kayak seporsi kalau kita makan, misalnya makan di luar take out gitu ya. Ada burger sama side-nya. Side-nya kita kayak bisa pilih ada onion rings, ada sweet potato, ada fried rice kayak biasanya. But I figured out when I came to the state, I just realized that I love onion rings so much. So that's some discovery. Number four is like when we made our own burgers with like mac and cheese and, you know, potato chips.
Yeah, okay, so fun fact, I'm also a big fan of onion rings. So number five is mine, actually, that's onion rings. Jadi, onion rings tuh ini, kalau teman-teman di Indonesia, adanya di mana ya? Di Awe? Di mana ya? Aku lupa. Jadi, itu kayak bawang bombay, kan? Bawang bombay terus dikasih kayak di, apa sih? Kayak di, shred gitu, terus habis itu dikasih tepung dan digoreng. It's so good. Itu sama root beer. Root beer tapi tidak beralkohol ya, teman-teman. Kalau teman-teman pernah ke AW, root beer, nah itu kayak gitu. Di sana brandnya ada banyak. Oke, okay. I think we can move on, Kak. Oke, okay. Anyone? Number one, number two?
I'm number one, again. This restaurant is actually like more Midwestern. Like, I think it starts like from Arkansas to like some other states in the Midwest. My mom's family is from Oklahoma, which is like the state in the direct middle of the United States above Texas. And so it's like a regional restaurant. We don't have any in Georgia, but I really, really like it there. It's like a restaurant and there's also like a tiny grocery store. So they sell like fresh produce and stuff like on the side, but they have like burgers and ice cream and that's kind of their thing. And they make really good cherry limeade, which is delicious. And I haven't had it in years because there aren't any on the East Coast.
Yes, iya sih, Brahms, I think I've heard of it. Kalau, jadi ini tentang kayak chain restaurants, I think Whataburger is a chain restaurant, I think Brahms is also. Kalau nomor tiga itu punya aku, itu Made Rights. Jadi Made Rights itu sangat-sangat Midwestern, jadi itu kayak burger, tapi dagingnya tuh bukan kayak patty yang kayak di Indonesia biasanya, jadi dagingnya tuh berantakan banget gitu, nggak nyatu. Dan fun fact, itu namanya Taylor's ya, dan nama keluarga aku yang di US juga Taylor, tapi kayaknya bukan kami yang punya, bukan. Cuma namanya kebetulan sama. So, fun fact. Okay. Number four?
Number two sama number four itu punya Elsa lagi, Kak. Jadi ada tipikal restoran yang Texas banget, karena kata host mom Elsa itu cuma ada di Texas, namanya Whataburger sama Bill Miller Barbecue. Nah, Whataburger ini dia serve burger aja sih, kayak varied, banyak banget macam-macam burger gitu. Terus kalau Bill Miller Barbecue itu ada kayak apa ya, steakhouse, terus ada barbecue juga, kayak rasa bingung jelasinnya. Terus di situ juga kalau kalian bisa lihat ada pie, itu lemon meringue pie, I love that so much. Itu kayak pie dari lemon, terus atasnya ada putih telur yang ngembang gitu. That's really good. Okay, by the way, Kak, habis ini kita langsung ke bagian Michael sama Megan dulu. Okay, so we can continue to chit-chat about food afterwards then. Nah, sekarang cultural differences in the USA will be presented by Megan, Michael, Kak Danu, and Kak Zikra. Oh iya, tadi Kak Danu itu belum sempat kenalan. Nah, for Kak Danu, boleh nih kenalan duluan sebelum mulai presentasinya.
Halo semuanya, perkenalkan nama aku Danu. Hi everyone, I'm Danu. Dan aku alumni KLYS tahun 2017-2018. Waktu itu, I was hosted in California. Glad to meet you all today.
Thank you, Kak. Okay, now, Megan, Michael, Kak Danu, and Kak Zikra, please present about cultural differences in the USA. Time is yours.
Okay, so we're just going to start off. Michael and I are going to just alternate discussing some of these cultural differences in the US. So I'll start with personal space. So Americans tend to require more personal space than some other cultures. So if you're talking to someone and you're too close to them, they might feel a little bit uncomfortable and they'll try to back away. And then also, like, usually you don't touch people that you don't know very well. So it can be like considered a bit too intimate. And then if you're like a close friend with someone, then it's okay, like you can hug them or whatever. But you should avoid physical contact unless it's a close friend. And then an exception to that is shaking someone's hand, which is kind of what's expected of you when you're meeting someone in a formal or business setting.
And then like in behaviors, like Americans can be more like assertive than most international visitors. So like, don't be offended if someone says something that you find like direct, and you feel free to be direct back to them. Making eye contact while talking to someone is like often a big deal. Like in class, like if you're giving a presentation, at least for me, like you have to like have eye contact with your teacher and like all your students when you're doing the presentation. And it can be considered disrespectful to avoid doing so. And many Americans are happy to discuss current events, but it's best to avoid controversial topics in the workplace and with people you just met, including topics related to personal values, religion, money, and politics, definitely. Americans ask you how your day is going without expecting like an answer, and Americans value independent thinking.
Alright, maybe di sini aku sama Kak Danu tuh bakal lebih kayak translate into Indonesian. Mungkin dari aku sendiri itu bakal ngejelasin tentang personal space. Di Indonesia, most likely people don't really understand what is personal space, something like that. So, kayak misalnya kita dulu banget, misalnya aku SMA gitu, bilang ke teman, personal space, like most of my schoolmates don't understand that. Jadi tuh kayak di Amerika tuh ada namanya personal bubble. Jadi kalau misalnya kita ngantri, terus terlalu dekat sama orang, and people be like, will back away, bakal ngejauh, ngapain ini dekat-dekat ini, mau ngelakuin apa nih, gitu-gitu. Jadi kayak mereka become, uncomfortable, kayak ngerasa nggak nyaman. Sementara mungkin di Indo, maybe nggak semua Indo yang kayak gini, tapi di Indo lebih cenderung kayak ngantri dan jaraknya 15 cm or something like that, it's still okay. Kalau di Amerika mungkin butuh kayak 1 meter or something like that. Terus mungkin Kak Danu mau ngejelasin tentang behavior.
Okay, terima kasih Kak Zikra. Jadi di Amerika itu emang mayoritas orang itu lebih direct dalam berkomunikasi. Jadi mungkin apabila teman-teman ke Amerika nanti, jangan terlalu tersinggung kalau misalnya ada seseorang yang terlalu direct dalam berkomunikasi ke teman-teman. Kayak waktu itu, host sama aku, waktu aku gak makan sayuran, beliau langsung nanya, kamu gak suka sayuran ya? Kalau misalnya gak suka, bilang aja, karena biar nanti ke depannya gak dimasakin sayuran lagi. Nah, kalau kayak gitu, itu tuh menurut kita kan lebih, sangat direct ya, sangat langsung. Tapi menurut mereka tuh hal itu penting untuk memastikan bahwa kedepannya aku nggak buang-buang makanan dan nggak makan dengan tidak makan sayuran yang dimasak lagi, seperti itu. Lalu juga benar banget ini, many Americans are happy to discuss current events, tapi lebih baik untuk tidak untuk menghindar dari pembicaraan yang berbau SARA, seperti di Indonesia sih sebenarnya sama, karena di Amerika juga itu kan sangat beragam ya manusianya, jadi sudut pandangnya juga beda-beda. Nah, untuk topik-topik yang berbau SARA, keuangan, personal values itu lebih baik untuk dihindari. Kemudian juga Americans can ask about how your day is going without expecting an answer. Mungkin dari kakak-kakak di sini dan teman-teman KLS juga, KLS board juga tahu bagaimana kalau misalnya kita lagi di supermarket di Amerika, di kasir, kasirnya itu suka tanya ke kita kayak, how's your day going? Or, how is it going? Tapi muka mereka setelah kita jawab tuh nggak menyambut ada jawaban lagi, jadi mereka cuma bilang kayak gitu aja, seperti itu sih. Boleh lanjut.
That's so true. Yeah, that's so true. In Amerika tuh banyak banget small talking-nya, meskipun mereka direct, tapi juga small talking. Jadi ke kasir, hey, how are you?
Always. Tapi ketika kita balas nggak terlalu excited sih, Kak.
Yeah, that's true. Okay. Maybe now Megan and Michael can explain again about this, like tipping timelines.
Okay, so a big part of American culture that many foreigners aren't aware of is tipping. So in almost every situation when someone is helping you with a service, like a waiter, a hairdresser, a taxi driver, a bartender, a masseuse, like anything, Americans will provide a small tip on top of the total cost of their bill. So I had a friend who wasn't from America and he was getting his haircut and he just like kept going back and he didn't realize he was supposed to tip the haircutter. And after a while, he was like, I don't know why, but the haircutter isn't friendly anymore. And I was like, are you tipping him? And he's like, no. So then he started tipping the hairdresser and he was friendly again. So it's just an important thing to remember. Like, a lot of these workers are expecting you to tip them. So they'll really appreciate it if you follow that tradition.
In the USA, it's preferred that you either, like, you're either on time or a few minutes early for the start of the meeting. Or in very rare, can be disruptive, like someone else's schedule, because like Americans are very, very, very scheduled. And arriving more than a couple minutes late is both disruptive and considered rude. People set a time for most daily events that they will leave, like an early event, to make sure that they are on time for their next appointment. And time is especially important in work and school settings. But here's like the kind of difference. So I'm from the South, and like time is a lot different than it is for most of America in the South. So like everything goes so much slower. Like if you have a party, people probably won't start showing up till like either like 30 minutes later, because it's just like, it's just so slow here. Ooh.
Okay, so if you're invited to an event in America, like a wedding, a baby shower, a religious event, or any other celebration, it's expected that you bring a gift or you send one ahead of time. It doesn't have to be a big gift, but it's just like important for you to show your appreciation for being invited.
So this was recently changed, I think in January or December, but in the USA, you must be at least 21 years old to buy cigarettes, and buying them for someone else under like 21 is illegal. And like, it's like highly taxed by the government. So like, it'll add cost to your budget. And for most of America, it's considered like extremely, like this is an extreme offense to smoke, like in public areas, like in parks or in like anywhere near businesses or anything like that. So like, there's usually designated spots to smoke, but it's just like, if you're on the street and smoking, usually like people probably like stare at you and stuff like that.
Okay, and then another cultural difference is our names. So most Americans will have three names. We have a first name, a middle name, and a family name, which is like your last name or your surname.
All right, maybe we got what translation-nya tuh kayak di Amerika tuh tipping-nya tuh penting banget. No wonder waktu misalnya kayak kita ke Amerika gitu, ke resto, pelayanannya itu friendly banget, tapi ya itu, mereka tuh expect kita buat tipping maybe around 10% dari total harga meal-nya, 10-20%. Karena memang itu udah budaya banget, kayak para pegawainya tuh butuh extra money, something like that. Terus buat timeliness, ini ya beda banget sih ya, buat di Indo itu kayak kita tuh nggak semuanya begini, but a lot of our friends usually punya jam karet, jadi orang-orang tuh banyak yang telat. Mungkin kalau kita hangout, guys, ketemu jam 4 ya, tapi kita jam 4 baru berangkat gitu. Kalau di Amerika tuh it consider rude to be late, kayak kita tuh kayak ngerasanya kayak nggak menghargai waktu mereka, something like that. Nah gitu. Terus kalau Kak Danu mungkin bisa ngejelasin yang lain, gift giving.
Oke, untuk yang gift giving itu emang di salah satu apa ya, aspek penting dari budaya Amerika itu kayak memberikan hadiah, entah itu pada saat Natal, entah itu pada saat pernikahan, baby shower, dan lain-lain. Karena kalau misalnya kamu diundang suatu acara namun kamu nggak bawa hadiah atau bawa kado, itu sangat, apa ya, sangat aneh kayak gitu. Makanya it's expected for you to bring a gift when you're invited to an event, whether it's religious, whether it's a wedding. So that's that. Dan juga untuk merokok itu emang agak jarang untuk menemukan orang yang merokok di publik di Amerika, khususnya di tempat aku ya. Cuma kalau misalnya anak sekolah itu mungkin ya sama, hampir sama kayak di sini sih ya, ada yang nakal-nakal juga kayak gitu. Jadi untuk peraturannya emang seperti itu, cuma anak sekolah tuh ya adalah seperti kayak di sini juga yang nakal-nakal yang rokok di sekolah dan diem-diem lah di tempat yang tersembunyi seperti itu. Dan juga untuk nama memang orang Amerika punya tiga kata, yaitu nama depan, nama tengah, dan nama belakang. Dan nama belakang itu juga apa ya, tempatnya penting banget gitu loh di Amerika, karena di berbagai hal penulisan nama itu mulai dari nama belakang, lalu koma, dan mulai dari nama depan seperti itu. Jadi banyak orang yang seperti guru-guru kayak gitu itu dipanggilnya nama belakang. Kalau kamu panggil mereka nama depan itu nggak sopan. Seperti itu, Kak.
Atau terus kalau bisa dibolehkan manggil nama depan gitu ya, Kak?
Iya. Ntar gurunya aneh, Kak. Kaget.
Oke,
gurunya.
Kak, tadi mau nambahin apa?
Ini sih kayak bisa lihat juga dari chat-chat kita di Zoom ini, di chat Zoom. Kayak ini juga sebenarnya tergantung di daerah US-nya juga kan. Kayak tadi tuh dijelasin tentang small talk di US itu is a huge thing. Tapi kalau misalnya di daerah East Coast kayak New York atau something like that, itu kayak kelihatannya tuh ini wasting of time. Tapi kalau misalnya di daerah selatan or Midwest, di Amerika tuh people suka talk banget. Jadi itu memang tergantung daerahnya juga. Terus juga itu tadi Michael juga dan juga ngejelasin, Kak Elsa juga ngejelasin ya, kalau misalnya orang terlambat di Texas itu kayak kesannya biasa aja, nggak kayak daerah lain, mungkin kayak di Northeast, kayak New York, itu mungkin orang tuh harus tepat waktu banget, nah gitu-gitu.
Oke, Kak, makasih banget udah jelasin tentang slide ini. I would like to ask to Michael. Michael, are you going to leave now for your next agenda?
I think I'm fine for 10 more minutes. Is that okay?
Okay. Okay, so we can continue, Kak? Atau gimana? Okay, good. We can continue then. Okay, this is still Michael's and Megan's part, so you guys can take over.
Okay, so in America, elders don't really have the same level of respect as they do in other countries like Indonesia. So people will tend to give more respect to, like, based on your profession. So like if you're a professor or a business leader, or if you're wealthy, people will tend to view you in a higher regard and give you more respect, which is a big adjustment for older newcomers who are expecting people to respect them, and then they get here and it doesn't happen.
And for health, many people visit the doctor for yearly checkups rather than just when they are sick, and doctors are highly respected, like in American society. And if a healthcare worker will not talk to you about your family members in medical care, do not take this as a sign they're like being rude. Like, our law says that we are not allowed to discuss like a patient's health with other people unless the patient signs a form to give permission. So like my parents like work at hospitals, and they cannot tell me like anything like that they do at their like that their job about patient care.
Okay, the next topic that we're going to talk about is counseling. So counselors are very well respected in America, and it's very common for Americans to see a counselor or a therapist to help them through the death of a family member or other sad or hard events, or just to help them with their mental health. Also, almost every school in America has a counselor to help students achieve their goals, such as going to college. At my school, we actually have a separate counselor just for college counseling. And then we also have a mental health counselor. So you go to one person to talk about college, and then you can go to another person to talk about any other events that are on your mind.
And family, girls continue with their education just like boys do. We all go to public, like we all go to school together, and we all go to college. And American boys and girls both help with chores. So like my family, it's like I'm like an only child, and like I'm a boy, and they still make me do like all the chores. And American girls are not expected to run a household. And I don't like consider the last part to be really true, because I mean, when you become when you get married and stuff like that, I think like you pretty much share responsibility of the household between your husband and your wife and stuff like that for most cases. And because like wives usually have jobs just as much as like husbands do. And because it's like America, like everyone works pretty much.
Yeah, that's true. Tadi Megan and Michael itu ngejelasin kalau misalnya di elders, orang-orang tua, misalnya di US itu mungkin nggak langsung dapat auto respect. Jadi itu respect itu diberikan mungkin lebih kepada orang-orang yang sukses, business leader, professor, something like that. Jadi kayak, okay, it's about elders, tapi aku bakal lebih ngomong beyond that. Aku bakal lebih ngomong kayak senioritas. Mungkin kalau di sekolah sendiri juga just because kamu senior, itu bukan berarti kamu langsung di-respect gitu aja gitu. Malah jadi kayak si anak yang kelas 10, itu lebih di-respect sama anak kelas 12, yang mungkin si anak kelas 10-nya itu salah satu atlet terkenal di satu sekolah gitu. Sebenarnya itu lebih cenderung dapat respect daripada si senior-senior yang nggak ngelakuin apa-apa gitu di sekolah mungkin. Mungkin kalau Kak Danu ada cerita lain?
Benar sih Kak, jadi kalau misalnya yang apa namanya anak kelas 9, 10 yang lebih terkenal gitu, emang lebih apa ya, lebih diketahui, yang lebih diketahui itu dapat lebih dapat respect daripada yang senior yang kita nggak tahu nama mereka siapa, terus cuma ngelihat sekali-sekali aja kayak gitu sih Kak.
Yeah, that's true. Terus juga yang tentang family roles, jadi mungkin di Indo kayak ketemu supir bus cewek gitu, orang mungkin bakal surprise or something like that, but in the US, kayak rata-rata, nggak dominan juga sih, tapi kayak it's quite common ngelihat yang supir bus sekolah itu perempuan, jadi mereka kayak it's okay, kayak gender equality itu udah lebih advance dari dulu, something like that, gitu.
Untuk counseling, emang betul banget kata Megan tadi, di sekolah aku juga waktu di Amerika itu ada counseling yang berbeda, ada untuk mental health counseling dan college counseling. Dan college counseling itu kalau nggak salah cuma ada di semester genap, di mana anak-anak kelas 12 itu menyiapkan kayak berkas, esai, segala macam untuk masuk ke perkuliahan. Jadi emang counseling itu is a big part of American culture, especially also in high school, karena kayak kalau misalnya kita lagi ada masalah di sekolah atau kita mau melakukan sesuatu, kayak mengubah jadwal, contohnya waktu itu aku pernah mengubah jadwal itu juga ke counseling, karena mereka yang ngebantu kayak, kamu bener gak mau masuk kelas ini, kayak gitu, atau kelas ini kayaknya cocok nih buat kamu, kayak gitu. Terus juga di keluarga Amerika itu, anak perempuan itu sama levelnya dengan anak laki-laki. Jadi anak perempuan, mau anak laki-laki, keduanya itu biasanya ada tugasnya masing-masing di rumah. Jadi mereka berbagi tugas di rumah. Jadi nggak hanya anak perempuan misalnya yang mengerjakan tugas di rumah seperti itu.
Okay, thank you so much, Michael, Megan, Kak Danu, and Kak Zikra for presenting about cultural differences in the USA and mention what's different from in Indonesia. Now we get going with our previous presentation materials about food. So, untuk Kak Anya, Kak Bianca, Jesus, and Edison, time is yours again.
For this slide, Addison, you can go ahead.
Thank you. Okay, so dining culture. In general, Americans try to eat neatly without making a lot of noise, and it's considered kind of disrespectful if you do make noises while you are eating in front of people. Food should be lifted up to the mouth, and you don't bend over to eat it. Don't talk with your mouth full, just a couple of things that everyone tries to do because it's considered disrespectful. Table napkins are placed on your lap, folded in half if they are very large. The napkin rests on the top on your lap till the end of the meal. If you excuse yourself from the table, loosely fold the napkin and place it to the right or left of your plate. Do not refold your napkin or wad it up on the table either. Never place your napkin on your chair. For the most part, Americans don't usually use like napkins, at least in my experience, unless you're like at a fancy restaurant or like a fancy event. But yeah, there is some things that are considered disrespectful with that as well. If you're in a small group, it is polite to wait to start eating until the host sits down and begins. With larger groups, you may begin after noting that a few people have begun. You also may begin if the host urges you to. That's also true. It depends on the type of people that you're with, but depending on who it is, it's just a kind gesture to wait for them to get their food as well, so you can both start eating together. But it's not like something that's required, but it is considered it's like kind if you do that. You use your fork, knife, and spoon to eat your food. There are some exceptions like lobster and corn on the cob, cookies, shrimp, and fried rice or fried chicken and other foods. If you do eat with your hands, don't lick your fingers to clean them, and you use the napkin. If you have to take food out of your mouth, such as like a pit or a bone, you do it carefully and quietly. It's not polite to pick your teeth at the table to remove trapped food. If you must do this before the end of the meal, excuse yourself and go to the restroom. And you can usually ask for a toothpick as well, instead of having to like dig around your mouth with your finger. So yeah, those are definitely some cultural norms here.
Berarti culture di Amerika ini agak mirip ya kak ya dengan yang di Indonesia. Kan di Indonesia juga kita biasanya kalau mau makan bareng sama orang itu kita nunggu dulu makanan teman kita tuh datang, baru kita makan sama-sama gitu. Terus juga jangan ngecap, itu kayak sangat-sangat familiar ya sama Indonesia. Jadi Indonesia sama Amerika tuh sebenarnya nggak sebeda itu gitu ya kak ya.
Benar. Ini yang bedanya yang pas don't lick your fingers itu deh kak. Karena di Indonesia kan kalau misalkan kita makan pakai tangan, kita suka licking our fingers. Karena misalnya the food is really good or you know something. I think it's just cultural.
Okay. Terus another thing juga yang aku notice juga, mereka tuh kalau nggak salah, kan aku biasanya sendok di kanan, garpu di kiri gitu. Kalau mereka tuh kalau nggak salah garpunya di kanan. Terus yang di kiri tuh pokoknya yang lain, pokoknya di kiri aja. Jadi yang kanan tuh biasanya garpu. So that's also different. Yeah.
Okay. Oh iya, benar-benar. Aku setuju. Soalnya pas aku di Amerika, aku mikirnya kan mereka bakal makannya pakai sendok gitu kan, sendok garpu gitu. Ternyata lebih seringnya tuh cuman garpu aja. Jadi aku kayak kaget makan gitu, nasi. Tapi kayak makan nasi juga pakai garpu
doang.
Exactly. Jadi kayak makan tuh using fork. Gimana kalau Jesus, Edison, Connor, and Megan, do you like use what utensils that you use when you eat?
I use a spoon.
Ah, I see.
Finally.
Yes, Connor?
I use a fork.
I usually use like a fork and a knife, and that was a really big adjustment when I went to Indonesia because there just weren't knives and I didn't know how to cut my food without it.
I never use knives. People think I'm weird here because
I don't hardly use knives either. Unless it's like meat and then I'm like cutting it actually. But like most of the time I don't use knives.
Americans even have spork, right? Like they in like school cafeteria, they provide you with spork. You know, either you use fork or spoon, it works well with spork. So
spork is kind of weird. It's hard to use. Okay. For this light, Jesus, you can go ahead.
Okay, so making a reservation at a restaurant is like any other appointment. You are expected to arrive at the scheduled time. And if you are running more than 10 minutes late, you should call the restaurant to let them know. And this usually only applies to like fancier restaurants, because usually fancy restaurants have like larger amounts of people that come in, or it takes them longer to make the food. So you should call in advance to make a reservation. But normal restaurants, you don't have to do that.
I I think she's freezing. I don't know. Maybe the connection. So yeah, and like hal yang besar banget dan kayak diperhatiin banget di US juga kayak keteraturan ya. Jadi kalau misalnya ngantri, ya ngantri ya. Teman-teman kalau Indonesia kan kadang suka nggak tertip gitu ya. Terus itu ya tentang when ordering food at the counter. Terus juga yang poin ketiga itu ketika ketika makanannya tuh udah habis, orang tuh biasanya ini langsung apa langsung keluar dari restorannya itu. Kalau di Indonesia seringkali kan ngobrol dulu ya kan, habis makannya kelar langsung ngobrol gitu.
My connection died. I'm so sorry.
That's okay. You can continue with like the tipping etiquette and stuff. The other.
Oh yeah. Since we already talked about that earlier, if you're eating at a restaurant, you should tip 15 to 20% for your server, and you don't have to tip at most self-serve restaurants. And these are restaurants where you order food at the counter and they bring your drinks and stuff to the table and you clear it yourself. And it's important to note that if you give like a small tip or no tip, you're basically implying to the server that you didn't like their service. And the more like you spend, so if you spend like $50 or $100, the more you're expected to tip because you spent a lot of money, so you should probably tip more. People in the US eat dinner early, like 6 o'clock in the afternoon is typical. And it's rude to have your phone at the table if you're eating with a group of people, especially if there's like people you don't eat often with. And yeah, the portions are large at a lot of restaurants in the United States. So don't be overwhelmed. Expect it in advance. If you're not sure, yeah, the portions will be massive. And if you don't have a lot of money and you want to order a drink, just get water. It's free.
Yeah, like sometimes when I go to like a fast food restaurant, they also have like free refill for like pop. Sorry, soda, I mean, for soft drinks. Don't laugh, Jesus. But yeah, so yeah, jadi di sana tuh bisa, kalau misalnya teman-teman pesen paket tertentu, misal mau ke McD atau ke KFC atau ke manapun, itu mereka ada. Jadi mesin soda ya. Mesin sodanya itu bisa teman-teman cari fill semaunya. Dan itu macam-macam sodanya. Kak Anya.
Iya, Kak Bianca.
Kalau Kak Anya tuh waktu di US ada yang bikin kaget nggak sih tentang kayak makanan atau habit makannya kayak gitu, kayak kok gini sih?
Mungkin ini sih Kak perihal ngebersihin meja gitu. Kan kalau misalnya di Indo tuh kita kebiasaan kalau misalnya habis makan ya udah tinggalin gitu kan. Paling cuma dirapiin di atas meja gitu aja karena juga tidak ada akses buat buang sampah segala macamnya. Tapi sedangkan kalau di US itu kalau misalnya kita udah selesai makan, apalagi nih di fast food restaurant gitu ya, misalnya di McD atau di KFC or something like that, kita habis makan itu harus kita rapiin dan kita buang sampah sendiri dan kita naro misalnya kayak ada piring segala macamnya tuh ditumpukan yang sudah disediakan gitu. Dan menurut aku itu kayak keren sih Kak, karena kayak langsung bersih gitu jadinya. Gitu sih Kak. Kalau Kak Bianca gimana Kak?
Iya sih. Benar, kalau teman-teman ke McD, biasanya udah dibilang kan dibuang sendiri ya sampahnya, itu tolong dilakuin ya teman-teman, karena itu mempermudah pekerjaan orang-orang yang di sana, di tempat McD-nya itu. Di US emang juga biasanya kayak gitu. Yang bikin aku kaget sih itu tadi ya, makan nasi pakai garpu itu aku kaget. Terus juga ini kalau makan malam tuh kadang jam 5, jam 6 gitu, kayak kok awal banget, entar lapar kan malamnya. Kayak gitu sih.
Setuju Kak. Mereka cepetnya benar-benar cepet yang kayak baru sore gitu, kayak okay, dinner gitu. Everyone ya,
udah makan lagi.
Go to the table gitu, kayak kaget loh sudah makan malam gitu.
Yes. Okay, dari aku kayak gitu sih. Silakan Kak Elsa.
Okay, thank you so much, Kak. Akhirnya kita udah bahas tuntas tentang dining culture in the US. Fun fact satu lagi, kenapa sih orang US selalu langsung pergi setelah makan? Itu karena biasanya di restoran yang terkenal tuh udah pada ngantri gitu. Ngantri di luar tuh udah banyak yang nunggu, jadi mereka harus cepat-cepat pergi buat gantian sama yang lain. Okay, so proceed to our next section. First of all, I want to ask, do you guys, yes, abroad students want to leave early or you want to stay because it's like 8 already. Do you guys have any agenda to, you know, Michael?
I think I might have to go. I'm sorry.
Okay. So we can, you know, take a picture together first before you leave then. So everyone please on cam. Ini siapa nih kak yang mau screenshot kali ini?
Nanti dari aku aja kak Elsa.
Oh oke, okay. Thank you kak Putri. On cam ya semuanya, kita foto dulu bareng-bareng sebelum Michael leave. Nih, udah siap nih
okay.
Kak.
Satu, dua, tiga. Lagi next slide. Satu, dua, tiga. Lagi ya. Satu, dua, tiga. Satu, dua, tiga. Oke, terima kasih semuanya.
Thank you so much, Kak Putri. Thank you, Michael, for, you know, making time for us and coming here.
Hi, guys. Thank you so much. It was so fun.
See you in our next session. Okay. Now, kita continue, Kak, ke presentasi kita nih. Karena masih ada, kita mau seru-seruan bareng. Masih ada agenda lain yang kita belum bahas. Nah, sekarang kita main tebak-tebakan. Seperti di acara sebelumnya, di Belajar Bareng Yes Part 1, ada tebak-tebakan juga. Nah, sekarang kita mau tebak-tebakan. Di mana sih ini Magnolia Bakery and World of Coca-Cola? Ada yang tahu? Kalau yang tahu bisa tolong isi di chat box ya. Anyone knows where Magnolia Bakery is and World of Coca-Cola? Cepetan Google tuh kata Kak Zikra. Okay, udah ada yang jawab nih. Ada yang bilang di Washington DC, ada yang bilang di Atlanta, New York, NYC, banyak yang bilang New York City. Nah, sebenarnya di mana sih Kak Magnolia Bakery sama World of Coca-Cola ini? Mari kita reveal the truth. Okay, so Magnolia Bakery ditemukan di New York dan amat terkenal hingga hari ini. Kalau ke NYC, New York City, jangan lupa mampir ya ke Magnolia Bakery karena sampai sekarang pun dia masih terkenal banget. Terus, World of Coca-Cola. Dia itu ada di downtown Atlanta. Nah, tadi yang jawab Atlanta benar nih. On May 8, 1886, Dr. John Pemberton sold the first glass of Coca-Cola at Jacob's Pharmacy in downtown Atlanta, serving 9 drinks per day in its first year. Coca-Cola was new refreshment in its beginning. So, you guys, Megan, Jesus, and Addison, have you guys been there? And how is it? How was it?
I've been several times because I'm from Georgia and I live in Georgia and I was born in Atlanta. So... I've been a few times. It's really interesting. They have like this big tour about the creation of Coca-Cola and Coca-Cola products and all of the like products that they own. So it's not just Coca-Cola. They own so many different drink products. It's wild. And they also have like a really big room where they have like all the different Coca-Cola products that they make globally that you can just taste. So it's like hundreds and hundreds of drinks in one room that you get to try. Some of them are weird because they don't exist in the US. So it's interesting. Yeah, I really like it.
Was it only drinks or like there's gum too perhaps or something?
Usually I think they just make drinks. They make like merchandise too, of course, like there's different products. And of course the bear, mm-hmm. The bear, which is like their mascot. They have lots of like stuffed animals of their mascot, which is adorable.
Right. How about the Magnolia Bakery? Oh, Kak Anya mau pamit duluan. Thank you, Kak Anya. Thank you for coming. Have fun. Thank you. Okay. So we can proceed to our next slide, ya, Kak. Ini udah, so mungkin kita... Bisa ke slide yang setelah cultural differences. Nah, oke. Tentang jalan-jalan di Amerika. Kalian pasti udah cukup banyak lihat ya transportasi publik yang ada di film-film. Misalnya di Marvel film yang kalau ada state-nya di New York, itu pasti kalian sering lihat yellow cab gitu-gitu. Terus kalian lihat orang juga naik subway, kereta bawah tanah, dan lain-lain. Nah, di Amerika, public transportation-nya itu kalau misalkan pesawat, dia yang terkenal tuh ada United sama American Airlines. Nah, terus untuk bisnya itu bis antar kota, kalau di kita ya, itu dia namanya Megabus. Nah, for the US abroad students, Edison, Jesus, and Megan, have you guys... what type of transportation you guys usually use for, you know, going to school or going anywhere, traveling? Which one do you guys prefer?
I use a car just for my main way to transport myself. Usually, like, trains and buses are only in cities from my experience. So you can't, there's, like, hardly any modes of transportation besides, like, walking, biking, or like Uber or your own car. Buses do, like, there are buses here, but I have never used one in the United States before. So at least for me, it's not my main mode, but in cities it usually is.
Okay, how about you, Megan?
So where I live, it's really important that you have a car because we drive almost everywhere. When you get to the city, it's more common to use a subway or a taxi. And then if you're traveling further, like, I usually just take a plane. So like if I'm going to the South or the Midwest, like anywhere that's not driving distance, I'll just take a plane over like a train or a bus or other forms of transportation.
How about Jesus? If you guys take like bus or subway or even taxi, how much does it cost you to, you know, come from place to place?
Good question. I usually in the city where I live, it's more spread out, so most people drive, but in Atlanta, whenever I go, usually just take the train or like the bus. And if you take both of those often, you'll have like a card for it and you just put money on it. And usually the bus or the train costs between like, it's been some years, so it's probably more now. So probably like $2
for a trip.
Yeah.
How about the others? Sorry, my connection.
Or we can I haven't used a taxi or the subway in a while, so I don't really know what the current prices are.
Me too. I think that taxis are usually pretty expensive though, just because like that's one of their only ways to make money. Like, it is just a job. And so the amount of money that you spend on like a short trip is like their way of making money. So as far as I know, taxis are pretty expensive.
Taxis charge you by like how long the ride is and not how far it is. Because Ubers, like, you get on the app and you pay in advance for how far it is. But taxis, from when you get in to when you get out, the price will go up. So like if you stop somewhere in traffic, the price will keep going up. So yeah, taxis are expensive.
And in New York City, it often like get traffic jam. Is that true?
I've never been to New York, but from what I've heard and seen, that is definitely true. And you're just stuck there. And so it's so expensive after like you're waiting.
I can imagine.
They'll just like get out of the taxi.
And okay, I've got to be honest, I've driven in New York before, and the traffic is not nearly as bad as it is in Jakarta. Like, oh, it's possible okay. to move it's in New York, in Jakarta, but...
So you can compare that.
That's so true. Like, I've been to Chicago before because I used to live nearby Chicago, and then, like, it's nowhere compared to Jakarta. Jakarta is so, like...
Yeah, it's... lebih banyak macet ya kak dan lebih padat juga. Okay, now we can proceed to our next slide kak, please. Nah, sekarang ini the real tebak-tebakan nih yang berhadiah. Okay, so guys, please prepare for this because you will, you know, siapa yang paling cepat dan paling benar duluan jawabnya akan dapat hadiah dari tebak-tebakan kali ini. Prepare yourself. So, tebak-tebakan apa nih kak kali ini? Let's proceed to our next slide. Nah, tourist attraction in the United States. Please tebak dari nomor 1 sampai nomor 4, jawab secara urut up di chat box nama-nama tempat ini ya. Nomor 1, 2, 3, dan 4. Yang paling benar dan cepat. Kak-kak yang lain tolong bantu lihatin ya kak.
Faelsa, aku boleh ikutan gak kak?
No. Ini khusus buat partisipan ya, kan? Ntar hadiahnya buat Kak Danu semua kalau gitu.
Oh. Waduh, keren nih Kak, gamesnya seru banget. Aku pengen ikutan jawab, tapi nggak boleh ya.
Ayo teman-teman, akan ada hadiah
teman-teman
menarik.
Teman-teman jawab biar dapat hadiahnya. Keren loh ini.
Ini gampang loh, ini yang sering kalian temui di film-film. Masa nggak tahu? Ayo, misalnya nomor satu, apakah nomor satu itu jembatan Ampela? Baunya nomor empat itu Suramadu, gitu kah? Udah ada yang jawab nih, Kak? Wah, ada yang bilang Brooklyn Bridge, Disneyland. Siapa nih, Kak, yang paling cepat duluan? Dan paling benar? Brooklyn, Disneyland, Times Square. Wah, langsung berebet ya jawabannya. Banyak banget yang jawab. Okay, anyway.
Yang benar dan paling pertama itu ada dari Sa Anak Kota, Kak.
Ya, yeah, that's true, Kak.
Sebelum dari Sa itu ada Raisa Amara jawab. Benar, cuma kurang satu. Aduh.
Kurang satu, sayang banget. Jadi yang betul siapa nih kali ini?
Dari
Karisa, Kak. Dari Sana Kota.
Dari Karisa?
Darisa.
Darisa.
Darisa, oke. Okay. Darisa Anak Kota ya. Dia nomor satu bilang, it's Brooklyn Bridge, number two is Disneyland, number three Times Square, and number four is Golden Gate Bridge. Oke, okay, buat yeay. Darisa Anak Kota, selamat ya, udah jawab tebak-tebakan kali ini dengan benar. Please chat Bina Antar Budaya, bisa di DM Instagram atau chat box di sini juga, kalau untuk pengambilan hadiahnya gimana. Oke, okay. Next slide Kak, please. Jangan, yang belum jawab, jangan khawatir. Kita masih ada banyak hadiah. Okay, now number 5, 6, to 7. Please, ayo kita cepet-cepetan lagi jawab yang benar. Nanti kemudian dapat hadiah lagi. Okay, jangan mau kalah sama dari Sa Anak Kota. Ini kata-kata yang lain, Kak Bianca, Kak Zikra, Kak Danu, pernah nggak, Kak, nih, ke sini-sini nih?
Untuk ya. Nomor 5 kan banyak ya ke atras terus kayak gini.
Iya benar banget.
Pernah sih. Salah satu dan kayaknya ini yang aku kunjungi deh. Cuma aku pastiin dulu ntar lihat namanya. Cuma kalau yang tadi aku pernah ke Disneyland sama ke Golden Gate Bridge di San Francisco karena waktu itu aku di California kan.
Nomor 6 itu pasti kita semuanya pernah ya Kak, karena kita orientasi pas sebelum pulang.
Iya. Jadi itu ada di Washington DC.
Iya. Ayo.
Yang nomor 7 terkenal juga. Nomor 5 tuh aku nggak akan tahu deh kayak kalau jadi teman-teman di sini karena kayak, hah ini apa ya?
Dan banyak banget kayak tiap step punya ya Kak ya.
Iya betul. Bener Kak. Nah, aku bingung nih ini yang apa ini, nih?
Di mana nih?
Ayo. Di mana nih kira-kira? Oh,
udah ada. Mantap.
Apakah Tanaya Maharani ini pemenang kita kali ini Kak? Please help me. Buat jawabannya. Oh, benar nih ternyata Santa Monica.
Ya, benar. So,
congratulations to Agnes Man. Iya benar enggak sih Kak? Tadi yang pertama jawab.
Itu yang jawab benar.
Tanaya Maharani.
Iya, yeah. Congratulations to Tanaya Maharani for getting our tebak-tebakan right. Buat hadiahnya, tolong itu ya, PC aja ke Bina Antar Budaya. Oke, okay, now next slide. Wah, ini makin banyak nih, Kak. 8, 9, 10. Ini juga terkenal banget. Mungkin Kakak juga pernah ke tempat-tempat ini. Karena ini kayak landmark yang sangat US, sangat Amerika. Yuk, sekarang kita tebak-tebakan lagi, teman-teman. Jangan khawatir, ini juga ada hadiahnya. Kakak pernah nggak sih ke nomor 8 gitu mungkin? Atau nomor 11 deh? Itu kayaknya accessible di state-state lain juga ada. Tapi kita nggak tahu nih ini yang di mana.
Aku nggak pernah, Kak.
Elsa pernah ke NASA sih waktu itu. Cuma kan NASA juga ada banyak cabangnya ya di Amerika ya. Jadi Elsa nggak mau spoiler nih yang di mana. Ada beberapa tempat peluncuran roket gitu di Amerika. Jadi nggak cuma satu tempat NASA doang. Cuma yang ini tuh kayak mungkin
markas utamanya gitu lah.
Markas ya, utamanya, iya benar-benar. Ini udah ada yang jawab nih, tapi patung Liberty aja jawabannya. Semuanya ya guys, ayo, dari nomor 8 sampai 11 harus urut dan benar. Baru deh nanti jadi pemenang kita. Yang nomor 9 itu bukan yang ada di Naruto ya, bukan Hokage ya.
By the way, yang nomor 9 terletak di salah satu dari dua state kembar, teman-teman. Jadi state-nya itu ada yang namanya utara, ada selatan.
Oke, karena ini Patung Liberty, Gunung Rushmore, Bryce Canyon, Kennedy Space, itu M. Zaki Fahrezi. Kita langsung choose aja nih, Kak. Apa sih jawabannya sebenarnya?
Yeay, benar.
Yeay, benar nih. M. Zaki Fahrezi benar semua. Keren, keren banget. Selamat ya, M. Zaki Fahrezi, to be our next winner. Nanti buat para pemenang yang tadi udah disebutin juga, tolong jangan lupa DM ke Instagram Bina Antar Budaya buat hadiahnya. Nah, Nam Dosan DKK pergi ke Silicon Valley. Di mana kah Silicon Valley? Buat for the US, for the years abroad. Jadi nggak saya bilangin US terus dari tadi. Where do you guys have been from the pictures that we, you know, we guessed together in our previous slides?
Okay, so I've been to the Grand Canyon because I'm right next to it. But I also actually went on a road trip around California. So I have been to San Francisco as well, so the Golden Gate Bridge. And it is so, so cool. There's a couple other places, but those were my top two.
That's cool. How about Megan and Jesus?
I've gone to all of the places that were in New York, so like the Statue of Liberty, Times Square, and the Brooklyn Bridge. And I also went to the Washington Monument.
Cool. How about Jesus, our last student?
What if I told you? I've been to none of them.
Okay then. So ini tadi, thank you for answering. And then the Silicon Valley ini terletak di San Francisco Bay area ya teman-teman, in Northern California. Nah kalau kalian nih pecinta drakor, kalian pasti tahu nih enam dosen DKK yang ada di drama Startup ini, mereka juga pernah mengunjungi Silicon Valley gitu. Nah sekarang our vacation packing list. Di mana sih tempat mana aja yang harus kita kunjungi kalau misalkan kita lagi ada di Amerika gitu kan? Do you guys have like any must visit place that we have to visit when we are in the States? Addison, Megan, and Jesus. Must visit place, like the top notch place that we have to visit. Or the place that really America, that people know that we're in America.
I have a hard time with this question because it really depends on the person. Mm-hmm. I definitely would nominate California just because there is so much variety to the things that you'll see there. Plus there's so much like diversity within the people too. So like the experience that you'll have depends on how outgoing you'll be. But if you like wander around, you will find so much to do and the people are so cool and interesting. But it's kind of expensive, but I definitely think that you can get a good perspective of the United States just from California. Like, I think it's a good representation of the United States because so many different types of people are there.
Totally agree with Addison. Totally agree. I second that.
Cool. I live on the East Coast, so mm-hmm. I might be biased, but I think you should go visit New York. When you watch American movies or American TV shows, most of the time they're in New York. So when you go there, you'll see like all of these things that you've watched on the screen before and you get to experience them in person. And it's just a surreal experience. So I have to recommend going to New York City.
Yeah.
Okay, so this is, okay, Jesus, you can go first. This is like the tempat rekreasi favorit kami, our favorite, place to hang out. Starting from Jesus, because Jesus haven't answered the previous question, please.
Okay, so these two, like on the left, like the second ones, those are both mine. So the top one is me at Myrtle Beach, which is a beach city in South Carolina. And then the bottom one is the mountain regions of North Carolina, and they're both really nice. And I'm actually in North Carolina right now. I took that today for you guys.
Oh, that's cool. Thank you. And who owns like the picture below? Is that Megan or Addison?
So I have the three pictures on the right. So I can go over those ones now. So in the top right corner with the sunset, that's my friend and I at the beach in Florida. We go to Indian Shores and it's really beautiful. I love it there. And then below that picture, it's my family and I when we were on vacation in Maine. So Maine is like one of the most northern areas of the United States. It's close to Canada and they have like all of these mountains and these lakes and it's just really beautiful. And then next to that picture, it's me and some of my friends and my sisters in Times Square in New York City.
Oh, that's cool. How about Addison? Is there any of your photos here?
I didn't get around to putting my pictures on there, but if I were to, you would see some of like all the different national parks in Utah because I am surrounded by them. There are so many. And so, like, honestly, you just drive and you will, like, run into a national park because there's so many here. People will travel outside of the states, like, the surrounding states to come to us. So most of the pictures I have is actually in Utah.
All right, that's cool. Okay, so as you guys can see, like the top left corner is me in Dallas. I actually live in San Antonio when I was in Texas, but I went for like a spring break trip to up to Dallas and even made it to Oklahoma. So it was in front of like the famous big eyeball statue. I don't know the exact name actually, but it really is a famous place. And right below it, there's like a tower. It made up like a famous city skyscraper in Texas. Itu isinya kayak ada 4D theater di dalamnya, terus ada museum juga, but mostly people go there for like the sky view. So it's awesome there. How about Kak Danu, Kak Bianca, and Kak Zikra? Before we proceed to our Q&A session.
My picture, gambarku tuh yang itu, yang di tengah, yang kayak ada setengah lingkaran itu namanya The Gateway Arch, itu di Missouri. Jadi tuh bisa naik lift, jadi di dalamnya tuh bisa naik lift sampai ke puncaknya, tapi itu sempit banget, dan kalau teman-teman takut ketinggian atau kayak mungkin vertigo atau kayak gampang pusing, itu agak serem sebenarnya. But it's so cool. Benar-benar cool.
Nah, aku juga pernah kesana, by the way. I think so cool.
Kak Zikra juga pernah kesana?
Iya, bagus banget kan ya, Kak?
Iya, pernah ke situ. Kan aku di Illinois. Tapi itu kan di St. Louis kan ya, di Missouri. Jadi ya Illinois, Missouri lumayan tetanggaan lah sama Iowa juga gitu. Jadi I've been there. And I think it's so cool gitu. Kalau memang itu kalau dilihat langsung tuh lebih keren lagi gitu. Kayak kalau di foto itu memang nggak ngetangkep betapa kerennya itu. Gitu. That's so cool.
Iya, yeah, tinggi banget, gede banget bangunannya.
Yes.
Habak Kak Danu.
Kalau aku kebetulan foto aku nggak ada di sini Kak, tapi untuk tempat rekreasi favorit aku itu di yang dekat sama placement aku itu ada Redwood National Park, dan di sana itu ada beberapa pohon-pohon yang memang paling tinggi di dunia Kak, dan bahkan 3 pohon tertingginya itu lokasinya disembunyikan karena menghindari aksi vandalisme kayak gitu Kak. Jadi benar-benar di sana itu pohonnya gede-gede banget. Bahkan ada salah satu pohon yang untuk ngelilingin itu waktu itu butuh 12 orang Kak. Aku sama teman-teman aku.
Gede banget berarti ya Kak ya?
Iya.
Keren-keren. Oke. Okay. Now, thank you so much for sharing your experiences guys here. So, we actually like have a really short Q&A session after this, but for you guys, yes, abroad students, you may leave now if you have like any other agenda, like, or you are in rush, but we will, you know, let you guys leave this meeting. Or if you guys okay to stay with us, we proceed to our Q&A session.
I actually have a conflict, so I'll be heading out. But thank you so much. This has been so fun.
Thank you, Addison, for being with us today. Thank you so much. Bye then. See you in our next session. Thank you. Okay, Megan and Jesus, so I guess you will stay here. Yes?
Yes, I can stay.
Okay, so our really short Q&A session. Kalian, teman-teman di sini, penasaran nggak sih sama kehidupan anak sekolah di Amerika gimana? SMA mereka atau dan lain-lain, kalian bisa ask us in the chat box ya. Nanti kita akan pilih 2 atau 3 pertanyaan yang menarik buat dijawab sama teman-teman kakak ES alumni and our ES abroad students. So please, kalau mau tanya tinggal ketik aja di chat box. Thank you. Nah, udah ada nih, Kak. Dari Firdaus Imran kali ya. Boleh open mic dan tanya ke kita, silahkan. Firdaus Imran.
Nah, kalau di USA itu ada kayak jurusannya nggak high school-nya, kayak IPA atau IPS gitu, kayak di Indonesia. Makasih, Kak.
Okay, thank you, Firdaus. So, guys, Firdaus was asking you actually, is there any, like, social or science class in specific in US high school, because in Indonesia we are, you know, divided into science class and social class. Jesus, probably want to answer first.
There are, I know it's not the same as like in Indonesia where that's like your whole like track like throughout high school, but they have classes for that if that's what you're interested in, and usually you have to take a science when you're in high school, and they have like a wide variety of them and different kinds, so it does depend, but yeah, they have them.
Okay, thank you, Jesus. How about in your school, Megan?
So in my school we don't have tracks, so when you're in high school you take like a wide range of classes and you don't specialize until you get to university. But then when you go to university, like you'll take, if you're in the social track, like, or humanities classes, like that's what you'll mainly focus on. If you're doing science, you'll mainly focus on science. However, there are some schools that are specialized. So some high school students will choose to go to a music school, or like a performing arts school so that they can focus on, like acting or music. There also are some science schools, but they're usually private. But if you just go to like your traditional public school in America, you'll have an opportunity to take science and like social science classes, but you can't like specialize until you get to college or university.
All right, so it's still in general, yeah, kalau di, if, you know, in high school. So next question. There's Miftahul Hanif Nawawi. For Miftahul Hanif, you can open mic and ask us directly, please. Miftahul Hanif, are you here? Okay, you can please open your mic and, you know, ask us directly. I think your microphone is still muted. Or you can, okay, then I will read the question. Acara party sekolah diadain berapa kali per semester? So how many parties you guys have in your high school actually? And when is it held usually?
I can answer it first. So right now we're not having any parties because of COVID.
That's sad.
So yeah, we're missing out. But usually there are lots of parties around sports games. So if your high school sports team is playing, then there's usually like a homecoming party or something like that, or just like a casual get together with friends. But yeah, I don't know. I hope that answered the question.
Thank you for answering, Megan. And how about you, Jesus, in your school?
The most times that I can think of is usually gonna be, like Megan said, homecoming week. If you're like a sports person, that's really big time. And also Halloween. Lots of teenagers like to have like Halloween like costume parties and stuff during that time. Those are like the two most common times. And of course, end of the year, because lots of students, especially like AP students, like to get together and like burn their textbooks because the class was hard and they don't need it anymore. So those are like the most common times that people have like parties.
Right, thank you for explaining to us. How about kakak-kakak nih? Last question to kakak-kakak. Party apa aja yang udah kakak-kakak datengin tuh waktu exchange di US? What kind of party you have attended?
Banyak banget kak kalau ngeliat itu dulu. Jadi kayak ada homecoming. Jadi homecoming itu kayak bulan pertama kita awal masuk sekolah. Terus ada party. Kayak gitulah, kayak everyone dress up, pakai jas atau baju formal, cewek-cewek pakai gaun, terus juga prom, tapi prom lebih kayak prom itu di akhir pas udah lulus-lulusan gitu atau hampir lulus gitu. Terus kayak it was so fun. Jadi dulu aku di SMA aku kebetulan apa ya, promnya tuh keren banget. Jadi promnya tuh bukan di sekolah, promnya tuh literally di kapal. Jadi kita di Chicago itu kan ada dekat apa ya, Lake Michigan. So, jadi promnya itu di kapal, benar-benar di kapal fancy, dan orang-orang party di dalam kapal itu anak-anak SMA. So, ada tiga, kapalnya itu gede banget, tiga lantai, terus ada genre DJ-nya masing-masing. Terus ya, it was so fun and fancy, like gila banget sih itu SMA aku dulu kayak. Benar-benar, that's so cool. Jadi karena dulu ekspektasinya tuh, ya, dulu aku waktu mau masuk ke US, aku expect nggak bakal kayak di movie-movie gitu kan. Karena kan memang namanya Amerika, of course nggak mungkin semuanya itu yang kayak di film itu benar gitu. But turns out, begitu aku ke sana, malah kebalikannya sih. Aku nggak expect jadi movie, malah turns out kayak rasanya tuh kayak lagi di film gitu sih. Di Chicago, di kapal. Jadi ya, it was so cool.
That's cool. Thank you, Jika, for sharing. How about Kak Bianca?
Terus ini, dulu kan aku ikut teater dan itu biasanya kita ada pertunjukan dalam satu tahun, aku udah dua kali. Nah, biasanya abis itu tuh pasti anak-anak yang abis tampilnya tuh pada makan bareng. Kayak pesan pizza misalnya, terus juga hangout di rumah temen, atau datang ke restoran, Mexican restoran, kayak gitu-gitu. Cuma kayak buat, oh kita udah selesai nih akhirnya, dan berhasil, sukses acaranya, kayak gitu-gitu. Sama paling kayak kalau lagi ini ya, kalau lagi bukan pesta sih, kayak ini Friday Nights Under the Lights, itu tuh kayak pokoknya setiap ada pertandingan, di pertandingan football di SMA aku, itu biasanya pada nonton, terus kayak pada pakai warna kebanggaan sekolahnya. Kalau sekolah aku biru sama merah, kayak gitu. Jadi kayak pakai baju sama pakai kayak makeup-makeup kayak gitu. So fun.
Oh iya, fun fact juga nih kak, karena disebutin warna sekolah, jadi tiap sekolah tuh punya kayak warna dan maskot masing-masing gitu ya kak ya. Keren-keren. Oke, okay, how about kak Danu?
Ya, kalau untuk parties ya, itu di sekolah aku itu ada homecoming, terus ada winter ball juga atau winter dance, sama ada prom. Terus kalau misalnya untuk maskot dan warna ya kata dia kak, warnanya itu adalah merah dan hitam, tapi kadang-kadang campur sama putih juga. Terus maskotnya itu adalah serigala.
Keren. Jadi emang warna ini kayak representatif sekolah gitu ya kak, kalau misalkan lagi tanding sama yang lain.
Keren, bener keren. Sih, kak, bener banget. Bahkan kayak di hari-hari random pun juga masih banyak, kalau di sekolahku ya masih banyak yang pakai sesuai dengan warna sekolahan kayak gitu loh. Mungkin pride-nya lebih gede kali ya karena di sekolah kecil.
Benar banget. Jadi semacam pride gitu. Okay, so yeah. That's it for today guys. Thank you so much for Megan and Jesus to, you know, stay with us until this session is end. Thank you juga buat kakak-kakak yang udah bantuin jawab di kolom chat. Thank you guys. So that's all we have for today. Untuk follow kegiatan dan program kami tentang YES Program, kalian silahkan follow Instagram at YES Abroad, at YES Program, and at YES Alumni Indo. And you guys can also visit our websites at www.yes-abroad.org or www.yesprogram.org. Gitu. Terima kasih udah datang di acara kami, udah seru-seruan bareng. And you know, stick to the end, kita nanti di acara-acara berikutnya. Thank you juga kakak-kakak udah menyempatkan. Thank you Megan and Jesus.
Sama-sama.
to stay with
us and for sharing today.
Thank you for coming, everyone. Semoga ada yang bisa didapat dari pengalaman-pengalaman yang berbeda ini. Bye, guys. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Take care with you today.